Advertisement, Prologue, and Dramatis Personae for The Follies of a Day, or The Marriage of Figaro, by Pierre Beaumarchais, translated by Thomas Holcroft. Advertisement. Though to thank the public is to thank nobody, since no particular person takes this sort of compliments to himself, yet were I not to feel that gratitude, which individually I know not where to pay, I were unworthy of past, of present, or of future favors. An author's thanks to the world at large may be seen under two very different aspects. For to thank the public is to tell the public he is successful, which, supposing it is true, it would be strange if they did not already know. It appears, therefore, only to be taking an opportunity of indulging his vanity, and yet to thank them seems his duty, since his silence might not only be construed a want of respect, but an arrogant self-confidence that, when they applauded or approved his work, they only did him justice. The reader must determine which of these faces he will please to view. I am so well convinced that the best writer stands in need of indulgence, and that he only does well by comparison, and might do much better, that I shall find little mortification in subscribing to the opinions of those who shall tell me I am in this latter predicament. Readers are divided into two classes. The one will allow an author much more than he merits, and the other much less. But the principal excellencies of The Follies of a Day are so known to be another's right that for me to claim them would be ridiculous. Some, however, have affirmed that it is a mere translation, who have never seen, read, or heard the original. If they had, indeed, they would have been still more culpable. Few will trouble themselves to examine the precise extent of my claims, nor, if they did, would they have an opportunity till Monsieur de Beaumarchais shall think proper to publish La Folle Journée. The public in general are so willing to overlook defects and applaud wherever they can, that to complain of or to be angry at the few who seek for and wish to find errors only can proceed alone from that self-love which is so inherent and irritable in all bosoms, and so difficult to subdue. To enumerate all the obstacles encountered and overcome in bringing this comedy on the English stage would be to indulge this vanity, which it is every wise man's pride and every prudent man's interest to resist. It may, however, afford some pleasure to be informed that, finding it impossible to procure a copy of the original French, though a journey to Paris was undertaken expressly for that purpose, the copy made use of in the composing The Follies of a Day was taken by memory only during 8 or 9 representations, that I furnished the plot, incidents, entrances, and exits, and gave some other occasional hints, that the remainder was the work of a young Frenchman, whose talents and whose heart are an ornament and an honor to his country, and that after it was brought to England and received by Mr. Harris, it was translated, cast, copied, recopied, studied, and in one of its longest parts, restudied, and played in little more than a month. The attention and care of Mr. Harris, and the merits of the respective performers in playing as they did under such circumstances, need not my encomiums. Had the town known the peculiar exertions of those especially who performed the longest and most essential parts, the applause would have been endless. From me, they are justly entitled to my warmest and sincerest thanks. Upper Marylebone Street, February 21, 1785.
Prologue. Tonight a child of chance is hither brought, who could be neither borrowed, begged, nor bought. Nay, so alert was said to be the droll, 'twas well affirmed he was not to be stole. But hence dispatched, back by Apollo's warrant, a messenger has kidnapped this wag errant. poetic fugitive has hither dragged him, and safely here arrived, has now ungagged him, to plead before this court his whole amenance. Where should you sentence him to public penance? Oh, sad reverse, how would he foam and fret, to sigh for Paris and his sweet soubrette? When twice 10,000 tongues are proud to greet him, and winged applause on tiptoe stands to meet him, where the grim guard in nightly rapture stands, and grounds his musket to get at his hands, where the retentive pit, all prone to adore him, repeats his bon mots half a bar before him, while every bel esprit at every hit grows fiftyfold more conscious of his wit. If far-fetched and dear-brought give trifles worth, sure you'll applaud our Figaro's second birth. Naught of his present merit must we say. Bear but in mind our day's a Spanish day. Cupid, in warmer climes urged by the grape, calls not each petty violence a rape, but oft his Voltaires leave intoxicate. Hence Figaro himself is illegitimate. Sanctioned by you, howe'er this little blot, so much in fashion will soon be forgot. That signature which each kind hand bestows shall make him well received where'er he goes.
Dramatis Personae, for the Follies of a Day, or the Marriage of Figaro, by Pierre Beaumarchais. Translated by Thomas Holcroft. Stage directions read by Larry Wilson.
Figaro, read by Todd.
Susan, read by Jen Broda.
Marcelina, read by Joanna Michael Hoyt.
Dr. Bartholo, by Scott Calkins.
Hannibal the Page, read by Cindy Gorman.
Count Almaviva, read by Jake Malizia.
Basil, read by Alan Mapstone.
Agnes, read by Therese Lindholm.
Countess Rosina Almaviva, read by Wendy Katz-Hiller.
Antonio, read by Ryan Williams.
Don Guzman, read by Greg Giordano.
Bounce, read by Adrian Stevens. Servant, read by Adrian Stevens.
Crier of the Court, read by Lynette Calkins.
Double Fee, read by Tchaikovsky.
Courier.
Act 1 of the Follies of a Day, or the Marriage of Figaro, by Pierre Beaumarchais. Translated by Thomas Holcroft. Act 1. Scene, the Castle of Count Almaviva. Figaro and Susan. Figaro measuring the chamber with a wand.
18 feet by 26. Good.
What art thou so busy about?
Measuring, to try if the bed our noble lord intends to give us will stand well here.
In this chamber?
Yes.
I won't lie in this chamber.
Why so?
I tell you, I won't lie in this chamber.
Well, but...
I don't like it.
Your reason?
What if I have no reason? What if I don't choose to give my reason?
Uh-huh. Thus it is, once they think they have us fast.
Are you, or are you not, my most obedient, very humble servant?
Your slave.
Bows very low.
Oh.
But whereupon take exception to the most convenient room in the whole house?
Yes, yes, the most convenient.
If during the night my lady should be taken ill, she rings her bell and, crack, in two steps thou art standing at her side. In the morning, when my lord awakes, he calls, I start and pop, three skips, and I am there.
Very true. And in the morning, when my lord has sent thee on some fine errand of an hour long, he starts from his bed as soon as Mr. Figaro's back is turned, and crack, in three skips, he...
Significantly.
He?
Yes, he.
Figaro keeps rubbing his forehead and looking at Susan.
He?
He. Dost thou feel anything?
Figaro presses his finger and thumb against his forehead.
Buttons in pairs. Mushrooms sprout not so suddenly. Yes, yes, it's a fruitful spot.
Thou knowest how our generous count, when he, by thy help, obtained Rosina's hand, and made her Countess of Almaviva, during the first transports of love, abolished a certain Gothic rite.
Of sleeping the first night with every bride.
Which, as lord of the manor, he could claim.
Know it? To be sure I do, or I would not have married even my charming Susan in his domain.
Tired of prowling among the rustic beauties of the neighborhood, he returned to the castle.
And his wife?
And thy wife.
Figaro stares.
Dost thou understand me?
Perfectly.
And endeavors once more, secretly, to purchase from her a right which now he most sincerely repents he ever parted with.
Most gracious penitent!
This is what he hints to me every instant, and this the faithful Basil, honest agent of his pleasures, and my most noble music master, every day repeats with my lesson.
Basil?
Basil.
Indeed. But if tough ashen plant or supple jack twine not round thy lazy sides, rascal.
Why wert thou ever wise enough to imagine the portion the count intends to give us was meant as a reward for thy services?
I think I had some reason to hope as much.
Lord, Lord, what great fools are you men of wit!
I believe so.
I'm sure so.
Oh, that it were possible to deceive this arch-deceiver, this lord of mine, to lead him into some excellent snare, pocket his gold, and...
Ha! Now thou art in thy element. Gold and intrigue, plots and purses. But let him that diggeth a pit beware he...
I'll try. The lover's jealousy and the husband's shame shall not deter me. Your trick, most noble count, is commonplace. A thousand blundering boobies have had art enough to filch a wife from the side of her sleeping, simple, unsuspecting spouse, and if he complained, to redress his injuries with a cudgel. But to turn the tables on this poacher, make him pay for a delicious morsel he shall never taste, infect him with fears for his own honor, to...
The bell rings.
Hark, my lady is awake. I must run, for she has several times strictly charged me to be the first at her bedside the morning of my marriage.
Why the first?
The old saying tells us that to meet a young bride the first on the morning of her wedding day is lucky to a neglected wife.
Going.
Prithee, my Susan, give me a kiss before thou goest. It will quicken my wits and lend imagination a new impulse.
To be sure. But if I kiss my lover today, what will my husband say to me tomorrow?
Seems to refuse. Figaro kisses her.
Pshaw, Figaro, when wilt thou cease to trifle thus from morning till night?
Playfully.
When I may trifle from night to morning.
In the same tone.
There, there, there's all the kisses I shall give.
Kisses her hand at him and runs. He pursues to the side.
Stop, stop, you cheating little knave. That was not the way you received them.
Returns.
Ah, a sweet girl, an angel. Such wit, such grace, and so much prudence and modesty, too. I am a happy fellow. So, Mr. Basil... Is it me, rascal, you mean to practice the tricks of your trade upon? I'll teach you to put your spoon in my milk. But hold, dissemble is the word. Feign we ignorance and endeavor to catch them in their own traps. I wondered why the count, who had made me steward and inspector general of the castle, should change his mind so suddenly and want to take me with him on his embassy to Paris, there to institute me his messenger in ordinary. A cunning contrivance, that. He, plenipotentiary in chief, I, a breakneck politician, and Susan, lady of the back stairs, ambassadress of the bedchamber. I, dashing through thick and thin and wearing myself to a skeleton for the good of my most gracious lord's family, and he laboring, night and day, for the increase of mine. Really, most honourable Count, you are too kind. What, to represent His Majesty and me both at once? It's too much by half. A moment's reflection, friend Figaro, on the events of the day. First, thou must promote the sports and feasting already projected, that appearances may not cool, but that thy marriage may proceed with greater certainty. Next, keep off one Madame Marcelina, whose licorice mouth waters at thee, and to whom thou hast given a promise of marriage, in default of the repayment of certain borrowed sums, which it would be very convenient to thy affairs never more to mention. Talk of the devil, and—
Enter Dr. Bartolo and Marcelina.
Good morrow to Mr. Bridegroom.
Good morrow to Madame Marcelina. What? My old fat friend the doctor? Are you there?
Yes, knave's face.
As witty, I perceive, and no doubt as wise as ever. And have you been complacent enough to come thus far to see me married?
To see thee hanged.
Most kind doctor. But who takes care of your mule? I know you have as much mercy on your beast as you have on your patient.
Do you hear him?
And you, gentle Marcelina, do you still wish to marry me? What? Because I cannot fall in love with you, would you drive me to hate you?
Exit Figaro.
The rascal will never mend.
'Tis you, doctor, will never mend. You are so eternally wise, dull, and slow, that when a patient has need of your assistance, he may die before you get to him. Like as formerly, your mistress got married in spite of your precautions.
Was it to entertain me thus agreeably that you sent for me in such haste from Seville?
Not entirely for that.
What then? Is anybody ill? Is the Count indisposed?
No, it is the Countess who is indisposed.
What, the artful, the deceitful Rosina? What's her disorder?
A faithless husband.
A very common complaint indeed.
The Count forsakes her and falls in love with every fresh face.
I am glad of it, I am glad of it. I foresaw it. I thought Count Almaviva would revenge the wrongs of Dr. Bartolo.
After toying with 1,000 neighboring beauties, he now returns to the castle to terminate the marriage of Susan and Figaro.
Which he himself has made necessary.
Oh, no. But at which he wishes to act rather as a principal than an agent.
In private with the bride.
Even so.
She, I suppose, has no great objection.
Charitable doctor. Basil, however, her music master, who takes great pains to instruct her, says to the contrary.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.